We're here in the studio with Mark Spencer, and we're looking at the latest release of Apple's Motion, version 5.3. We looked at Final Cut Pro 10.3 extensively on our free blog page, and you're probably watching this on our YouTube channel. Mark's going to walk us through the new features.
Exactly, Steve. So not nearly as dramatic as the changes in Final Cut Pro 10.3, which are really impressive, but there's several interesting and important changes in Motion that I thought we should talk about. And why don't we dive right in? When you first launch it, you'll notice it looks quite a bit different than the last version and looks very similar to Final Cut Pro 10.3. It's got the same flat, darker look, and where all of the different UI elements are kind of devoid of color and pushed to the background so that you can focus on your content. Several items have also been moved around. We now have several tool strips. We have this tool strip along the top that includes panes like the library, the inspector, the project pane, as well as the heads-up display, where you can choose each of those elements. It includes the ability to select objects, like we have a pop-up menu for adding things like cameras and lights and drop zones, pop-up menus for behaviors and filters, and particles and replicators are all on this top bar now. Under the canvas, we have a set of cursor-based tools. Each of these allow you to choose a different cursor tool. For instance, the tools here, or the 3D tools, or the hand tool, shapes, the pen tools, paint stroke, text tools, each change the arrow icon into a different tool to use. And then finally, under that are a set of transport controls. So all the same tools that we're used to, but just logically organized into these tool strips. The biggest difference to me, besides the look of it, is if you look at the top left, there is no file browser. Now, for some people, they would be, who cares, I never used it. For some people like me, this was a shock, because I used it extensively in everything I do. Right. And it took some getting used to, but I have come to the conclusion that it's okay, you don't really need it. So the question is now, how do you get material into Motion and how do you check it out before you bring it in? So if I click on the import button here, or Command I still works, we're brought to the Finder, but the Finder has gotten very powerful in terms of your ability to decide how objects look, which has worked for a long time in column view or list view or icon view. You can also sort them by these different sort options. And you can apply tags or search items by tags. So in a way, the Finder has more power than the built-in file browser had. And you can still preview anything just by selecting and hitting the space bar. So you can see exactly what you want to use. And you can import image sequences. So the essential answer is you just import through the Finder and you can get all your material into Motion just fine and work with it. You also have the option under the File menu to import as unused media. So if you want to collect a bunch of assets without using them in your project, you can use this menu to bring them into the Media tab and then choose when you want to add them to your composition. So in addition to the user interface changes, there are a couple of new features that I want to show that are related to specific behaviors. So in this project, I have two simple rectangles, and I'm going to select this one down here, and I'm actually going to rotate it a little bit too and move it over. And in the Behaviors pop-up menu under Basic Motion, we have a new Align To behavior. It's of course also available in the library under Behaviors under Basic Motion right here. And we get a little preview of what it does. So what I'm going to do is add it to this rectangle. And in the heads-up display, I'll say I want it to align it to this rectangle. And it immediately centers itself on that other object. Now, this Align To behavior works on any kind of objects, particle emitters, replicators, video, pictures, anything. This is just a simple example. If I select it in the heads-up display, I have some options. So rather than having these align by their centers, I can choose to have my original blue one have its left, upper left corner aligned to the upper right corner of the red object. And now they're both aligned. And no matter what I do with the red one, the cyan one or light blue one will now follow it no matter where I go. So very useful for quickly aligning different objects to each other. Another neat feature is that you can make it change over time. So if I select it again, rather than the transition set to none, I could do something like ease both. I'll set an out point, O and Command Option O for an out point for the play range. And now that object will move into place over time. So a lot of neat options to play with the Align To behavior. What's even better about it is this other feature, that you can use in combination with text. So what I'm going to do is turn on this text layer that I've added. And then with this red rectangle selected, I'll choose to add the align to behavior and tell it to align to the text. So now no matter where the text goes, it will match, but it doesn't match the width of the text. This is where things get interesting. I'll select the rectangle, go to the inspector. In the shape tab under geometry, this rectangle has a width and a height under the size. So for the width, I'm going to choose to add a parameter behavior called link. Now this parameter behavior is not new, but what is new, let's drag in the text to the well, is under compatible parameters, we have some object attributes. And right now we can choose the width of the text to match it to. So it automatically matches the width of the text. If I choose the text and type something else, it will always match the width of the text, which is great. And it even gets better than that. If I select the align to, we have some additional options to align to the baseline of the text, the ascenders or descenders, the cap height or the text X height. So we can be very precise in how we align it. So for instance, I'll choose to align this box to the baseline of the text, to the center. And then the box itself, I'll choose to align the top of the box to the baseline of the text. And now, no matter how wide or narrow this box is, it will always align itself correctly. So now I can make it more like an underline to some text that will automatically and dynamically change to the duration of the text. So a change to the user interface, no more file browser, but two very new cool additions in terms of the align to behavior and some additional powerful features in the link behavior.
Right, and Motion is all about behaviors. The fact that you can do this so quickly is just fantastic.
Yes.
So Motion 5.3, we have brand new training on our site for the new Motion. If you want to learn Motion, if you're a beginner and you want to learn all this stuff, this is kind of more advanced stuff, but we're going to be adding a lot more Motion content with 5.3 in the forthcoming week. So check back at ripplesaying.com. Thanks for watching all of our content.